good thing to gather, and we pray God's blessing upon everyone this day. It is the third Sunday in Advent. The anticipation builds as we draw nearer to our Savior's birth celebration. We mark the time with our Advent calendar, our Advent wreath, pardon me. And as you will remember, I'm sure, I don't have to review, but I do, nonetheless, that we began with a sense of hope as we moved into this new season. Hope brought us a sense of peace before the Lord. Today, as we light the third candle, it is the Sunday of joy. And what better way to mark joy than to invite the children to come? And so, as a part of today's worship service, children are going to present the nativity, how the birth of our Savior was recorded in Scripture. So we thank them for that today. But you guys got to be a part of this too. So, as you are coming in, many of you, some of you were saying, no, no, no. But I say, yes, yes, yes. Even if you didn't get a name tag, you are invited to be a part of today's performance, as it were, by being either an angel or a shepherd. And it's pretty low key. You're welcome to come to the front, but you don't have to. There's going to be one line for the angels and one line for the shepherds. It will come up on the PowerPoint when the right time comes. If you're an angel, joyfully proclaim that line to all. And if you are a shepherd, exuberantly proclaim that line when the time comes. And we pray that we are all blessed as we remember how our Savior came. We always invite some of our young people as much as we can to come and help us to light the Advent wreath. I'm wondering whether Ashton, is Chloe able to come? She's actually here. Jaden, would you come and help me too? We got three from one family. I'll invite them to light the candle, and then we will sing together our Advent song. So if you guys want to come around to the front there, I'll bring it to you. You guys want to come around to the front? Yeah.
Thank you.
confession now, knowing we need to unburden ourselves so that we may enter fully into that hope, peace, and joy, I invite the congregation to rise for our Advent confession and forgiveness. We find it printed on our PowerPoint. Brothers and sisters, blessed be the Holy Trinity, who is one God, the Lord of Israel, who comes to set us free, the mighty Savior, who comes to show us mercy, and the dawn from on high, who guides us into peace. Amen. Family of God, let us now come before God in confession. To you, O God, we lift up our souls. You know us through and through. We confess our sins to you. Remember not our sins. Remember us with your steadfast love. Show us your ways. Teach us your paths. And lead us in justice and truth. For the sake of your goodness, in Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Now I invite you to receive fully the forgiveness of God. Children of God, come with joy and draw water from the well of salvation. Remember the gift of baptism. Your sin is washed away in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. You belong to Christ. You are anointed to serve. Stand up and raise your heads. The reign of God is near. Amen. Let us proclaim this in song as we rejoice together, singing, Hark the Glad Sound.
Arise your light and sun.
together, heart and voice. Let us pray. Stir up the wills of your faithful people, Lord God, and open our ears to the preaching of John, that rejoicing in your salvation, we may bring forth the fruits of repentance through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. This time I'm going to invite any and all children or anybody who wants to physically be present in our little presentation to head towards the back. As they are making themselves ready there in the back, I'm going to bring just a brief little devotion for you to give attention to. Pray that you will be blessed as we reflect upon this. I'm going to try to do not too much preaching today, but I sometimes just can't contain myself. This is a reading written by an author by the name of Max Lucado, who's a devotional writer, inspirational writer, and it's just called Right Living. It's quiet. It's early. My coffee is still hot. The sky is black. The world is still asleep. But the day is coming. In a few moments, the day will arrive. It will roar down the track with the rising of the sun. The stillness of the dawn will be exchanged for the noise of the day. The calm of solitude will be replaced by the pounding pace of the human race. The refuge of the early morning will be invaded by decisions to be made, deadlines to be met. For the very next 12 hours, I will be exposed to all of the day's demands. It is now that I must make a choice. But because of Calvary, I am free to choose. So I choose. I choose love. No occasion justifies hatred. No injustice warrants bitterness. I choose love. Today I will love God and all that God loves. I choose joy. I will invite my God to be the God of my circumstances. I will refuse the temptation to be cynical. I will refuse to see people as anything less than human beings who have been created by God. I will refuse to see any problem as less than an opportunity to behold God. I choose peace. I will live forgiven, and I will forgive so that I may live. I choose patience. I will overlook the inconveniences of the world. Instead of cursing the one who takes my place, I will try to invite them to do so. Rather than complain that the wait is too long, I'll thank God for a moment to be in his presence. Instead of clenching my fist at new assignments, I'll face them with joy and courage. I choose kindness. I will be kind to the poor, for they are alone. I will be kind to the rich, for so often they are afraid. I will be kind to the unkind, because that's how God has treated me. I am a spiritual being. After this body is dead, my spirit will soar. And so I refuse to let what will decay rule the eternal. I will be drunk only on joy. I will be impassioned only on my faith. I will be influenced only by God, taught by Christ. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness. To these I commit my day. If I succeed, I will give thanks. If I fail, I will seek God's grace. And when the day is done, I'll place my head on my pillow and I will rest. May God make that so. Okay. Now, I need one thing. That more will be there. I'll give it back for you. So we invite you to just be present in this place. Some of you will have a role to play as I give you a little instruction. When your line comes up on the PowerPoint, if you are an angel, please speak it. If you are a shepherd, please speak it. But we want to represent to you, and thanks be to our children, who will show you the coming of the Savior. And it happened in this way. Long ago, the ruler of the empire, the Caesar, the emperor, declared, I want to know how many people live under my rule so that I may tax them and get money for my purposes. And so all those who lived under the Caesar's rule were told to go to the city that they were born in, the city of their family's lineage. And so it was that Joseph and Mary set out for Bethlehem. Traveling together, it was a long road. They had a donkey to help them along the way, sometimes carrying Mary, sometimes maybe being carried by Mary, for she was with child. And it was a long road. And it was a busy time, many people traveling to the cities of their lineage. And so Joseph and Mary got to Bethlehem and were looking for a place to stay, but everywhere seemed to be full. No matter where they went, every inn turned them away. They finally went, not to the Holiday Inn, but to the Bethlehem Inn. And at the inn, they asked the innkeeper, "Do you have a room for us, please? My wife is with child. Can we stay here?" And he said, "No room at the inn. But if you'd like to stay in my barn, you could probably make some space there." And so without any other choices, Joseph and Mary came to the stable. They tried to make themselves as comfortable as they could in this place. They nestled into the hay. It was warm and cozy amongst those farm animals. And the time came, and Mary gave birth to her firstborn child. She wrapped him in cloth. She laid him in the manger. Hard to take him out of her hands. But lovingly, he rested there because there was no room at the inn. And they rested as well. Now, close to Bethlehem, out in the fields, keeping watch over all of their flock at night, there were shepherds. And those shepherds were out there taking it easy. It was late. They figured it was time to relax. But while they were out there relaxing, suddenly an angel from God appeared before them. And the angel was shining gloriously, and the shepherds were very afraid, shaking in their boots. They were afraid. Oh, don't worry, they were. But the angel said to them, "Don't be afraid. I'm bringing you good news that is meant to bring great joy, because today has been born in Bethlehem a Savior, the Christ, the one who will set you and all people free from bondage to sin." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the A multitude of the heavenly hosts all praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." And then the angels, having given their message, returned into heaven. Away they went. And the shepherds all looked at each other and said, "That's incredible. I'll tell you what." They said together, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." And so they traveled, they journeyed, bringing with them their flocks, and they came and found the stable and the baby lying in it, and they worshipped the newborn Jesus the Christ. And then they kind of hung out for a little while because it was a good place to be in the presence of Jesus. Now, around the time of the birth, in fact, perhaps maybe even a little before it, there appeared off in the sky a brand new star shining brightly. And there were people off in the east who watched the heavens, knowing that sometimes God could declare new things, even using creation, if people had eyes to see and hearts to notice. And so there were wise people, magi, who came traveling a long way from the east, traveling by camel and horse and on foot. They followed the star, for it almost seemed to move, and it led them along the way. They learned from Herod that the new king would be born in Bethlehem, and so they continued coming all the way, and they found this child again in the stable and laid before this king their royal gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. And they, too, worshipped this newborn king. We all worship this king. He is the Prince of Peace. He is our Savior, our Christ. This concludes our little play. We thank you very much for giving your heart and your attention.
Thank you all to you, children. Yeah, maybe a round of applause or a part of the shepherds and wise people to join together in two verses of Away in a Manger, and we can find that up there. Let's give our hearts, our voices to that, and you children, you find it printed on the sheets there. Let's sing together. the Gospel of Luke, the 3rd chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. And Luke writes, John the baptizer said to the crowds that came out to be baptized by him, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruits worthy of repentance. Do not begin to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire." So the crowds asked him, "What then should we do?" In reply, he said to them, "Whoever has two coats must share with anyone who has none, and whoever has food must do likewise." Even tax collectors came to be baptized, and they asked him, "Teacher, what should we do?" He said to them, "Collect no more than the amount prescribed for you." Soldiers also asked him, "And we, what should we do?" He said to them, "Do not extort money from anyone by threats or false accusations. Be satisfied with your wages." As the people were filled with expectation, and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John, whether he might be the Messiah, John answered all of them by saying, "I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I is coming. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor, to gather the wheat into his granary. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I invite the congregation to be seated. Friends in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Well, once again, thank you, young people, children, who brought us the message in many respects. And I did sort of make a little bit of a promise, and I'll try to keep it relatively contained. But I do want to bring a brief reflection for us to consider today as we hear these words. The passage from Zephaniah, I didn't get up there, but it spoke about joy. That is today's focus in many respects. To think about what are the ways in which joy comes into your life. What are the ways in which you know joy, have known joy? And it says, "Sing aloud, O daughter Zion. Proclaim with joy that God is with you." And it sounds very joyful. Anybody know Handel's Messiah? He has encapsulated that with music, and it's beautiful, it's wonderful. And then we hear from Paul. You caught that as well, our reading from Philippians. "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice." We're going to sing that as our hymn of the day. We're going to give ourselves to that. And so, you know, we're Lutherans, and I get the wonderful privilege. I should just pick on Lutherans, Unitedians, Presbyterians, a lot of you. As a pastor, you can come to the front, and you can just look out and just see the faces beaming with joy, just radiant, just... I have to be careful, I guess you might say, "All right, Pastor, why don't you move on down the road?" But we don't always come into this place evidencing that. As Lutherans, we're pretty reserved. We kind of don't tend to give ourselves too much to exuberation, at least within the context of worship. We think worship is a solemn, sacred event, and it is. It is in some regards. It is right to come humbly before the Lord and to stand in God's presence. And that's why we've got this real interesting, can I use the word dichotomy? We've got these two very different kind of passages today. Right? We've got the passage from Zephaniah, filled with this expectation and joy and wonder in the presence of God. We've got Paul telling us, no matter what the circumstances may be, rejoice before the Lord, give thanks before the Lord. And then we got John the baptizer. "You brood of vipers." Maybe that brings joy to Lutherans, is to get that kind of good. We kind of feel like maybe we should be getting it a little bit. We've got to be hit by John as he comes and says, "You bunch of snakes." Does that fill you with joy? Yeah, no, not really. Not so much, does it very much? But he gives us some things. He says, take a look at your life. How are you living? How are you using what God has gifted you with? Because it is all a gift. It is all a gift. Creation itself is a gift to humanity to use and to share with all that shares life around us. It is not ours. It is God's. But God entrusts us with it. And that's at the very heart of what John is proclaiming to us. If we hear that message, that can move us to some sense of joy, to knowing how good God is, and that God desires others to be brought into that same circle of joy, and that sometimes that means giving of ourselves in some way, shape, or form. Have you got two coats? Can you give a second one? There's this classic story about two farmers who are sitting there talking to each other. We got a couple farmers in the audience here in the congregation. And one of them is saying, so Jake, you know what the Bible says, you know, if you've got something you're supposed to share with the other. If you've got two tractors, you're supposed to share with those who have none. Jake says, yeah, you're right, I know that one, you're right. And if you've got two combines, you're supposed to share with those who've got none. Yeah, you're right, I agree, that's in the good word, isn't it? And if you've got two bulls, you're supposed to share with those who've got none. He's like, hold on a second, you know I got two bulls. It's all well and good when it doesn't seem like it's speaking directly to me. But God does speak directly to us and say, take a look at your life. Maybe you don't have two coats, but what do you have? What have you been blessed with that you might be able to bless somebody else with? And at the very heart of it all, at the very heart of our proclamation, at the very heart of our faith, is the understanding that joy comes in the presence of the Lord. It doesn't come from all those other blessings that we so often look at that are very good things, but those things come and go, don't they? Joy can only be found when we reside and come before the Lord again and again and again, saying, you are my joy. You are my delight. You are the one in whom I have put my trust. You are the one who has saved me. You are the one who has provided over and over again. Let me find my joy in you. And I want to share one last story, and then I'm getting off. I don't know if you've been timing me, but I'm trying to keep it brief. But here it is. And it comes from an author by the name of Ruth Harmden, who's maybe not a real well-known, but she's written some Christian devotional books, poetry, these kind of things. And she, in one of her books, she talks about her mother, whom she had loved so very much and who lived a challenging life sometimes, but she made it through, and she kept the faith through all of this. And she wrote about a relationship that her mother had had with an old Scandinavian. Now, I've got some Scandinavian roots, so maybe I'm licensed to talk about Scandinavians a bit. But this old Scandinavian lady named Hilda, And how Hilda had worked in their home, had been a cook for very many years throughout her childhood and even beyond, until finally, later in life, Hilda got married and moved away. But they kept this relationship going, Ruth's mother and Hilda. And so I'm just going to read you Ruth's account of this. Ruth described Hilda as a plain woman with rough hands and a thick body. Actually, saying that she was plain was a delicate and diplomatic description. Hilda wasn't much for frills, so Harmden's mother used to knit practical things for Hilda so that she could wear up in the mountains where she resided with her new husband. Well, one Christmas, Ruth's mother knitted Hilda 6 pairs of woolen socks. What could be more practical than that? But she was also purchasing a beautiful cream-colored satin nightgown with a lace bodice for her granddaughter, who had just gotten married and was going to go on her honeymoon. And she thought, wouldn't that be a nice gift to give to her granddaughter? So she packaged them both up, and then she mailed them off into the mail, hoping that they would go to their place. But she kind of had this nagging feeling that maybe she had mislabeled those two packages when she had sent them off. If so, she knew she could probably make it up with her granddaughter pretty easy, but how would Hilda feel about getting this somewhat exciting, shall we say, nightgown in the mail? She could be pretty offended by that. She was a Scandinavian. I mean, she was a simple kind of person. So what are you going to do? Well, a few days after Christmas, she got an email from her granddaughter asking how she had guessed that their honeymoon was going to be a week of skiing, and how perfect a gift it was to get those woolen socks to keep her feet perfectly warm during that time on the slopes. Well, the worst had happened. She had sent the wrong gift to Hilda. How offensive. How damaging. How is she going to explain this mix-up to Hilda? But before she could even do that, she received a letter in the mail from Hilda. And this is what it said. She wrote it in her old Scandinavian style. I'll try the accent. But she wrote like this. Old Hilda, everyone thinks. She's only in need of things that will keep her warm. So they send old Hilda sweaters and mittens and socks. What could make old Hilda pretty, such a one as her? But you, my old friend, you have the other heart, the other eyes, and I am beautiful now. I open up the wood stove so that the room is full of heat. I put on this beautiful dress that was made for dancing. And what do you think? I dance. Old Hilda dances. Can you think of such a thing? And my Timothy, he comes to me and dances with me too. Ha! I think I make old Timothy fall in love with me once again. You make my heart dance, old friend. Your love is so big. The gift of Christmas looked like the wrong gift. This little child, born into poverty, born into a time of violence, corruption, political intrigue, but it reveals a love that is so big that makes us beautiful and helps us to dance. May God make that so. Amen. Joy of the Lord is ours. So we're going to sing, and on a day of joy, we're going to do things differently, so this is going to be something to be a little tricky, shepherds and angels. I'm going to give you a brief word of instruction. This song is called Rejoice in the Lord Always. Again, I will say rejoice. It's only one slide, so that slide doesn't have to move, but we're going to try and sing it in a bit of a round. So, what we're going to try to do is this side, you start with me, and we sing together, Rejoice in the Lord always, again I say rejoice, and then we'll continue on. But then you are going to try and follow Karen by singing that same line right behind you. We've got some wonderful singers on this side, so this is going to go real well. And no doubt of it, maybe it'll fill us with a little bit of joy, and if you want to get up and dance, you're welcome to do that. I got it. Dance in your heart, we sing together, we'll sing it through, I think, four times, so that we can really bubble with joy. Let's begin. Thank you.
congregation to be seated, and let us glorify God with the collection of our offerings.
Peace would come upon them, and yes, even your joy, knowing that death is only the gateway that leads us fully into your presence. For those who celebrate new life, we rejoice with them as well. The Lenson family, as they welcomed Wyatt Finley this last week, and we rejoice together and pray that you would increase their joy day by day. And I pray for my sister Beth, that she wrestles with health concerns, and guide the doctors with wisdom and understanding to discover what it is that she is ailing with, and whatever healing is possible, we pray and ask you for that. God, you are in the midst of us, here in this place and wherever we go. Hear the prayers that we offer before you. Help us to live lives that are faithful, sustained by your strength, and make us grateful every day for the good news of salvation until the day comes when your Son returns again to renew creation, fully reconciling it with you for all eternity. All these things and whatever else you know that we need, we raise to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would the congregation please rise for the great Thanksgiving? Family of God, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
Our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Father, Almighty and ever-living God. You comforted your people with the promise of a Redeemer, through whom you will also make all things new on that day when he comes again to judge the world in righteousness. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Brothers and sisters, we remember that on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples to eat, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom, and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Family of God, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Come, for all is ready. I invite the congregation to be seated.
Thank you.
Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, strengthen us and keep us unto eternal life. Amen. Let us pray. Holy One, we give you thanks because in this bread and cup we have feasted once again upon your endless love. We pray that that love would overflow more and more into our lives and through our lives, that we would be messengers to prepare your way, harvesters of justice and righteousness, and bearers of your eternal word, who is our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, brothers and sisters, I invite you to bask in the joyful blessing of our God. May the Lord bless us and keep us. May the Lord make his face to shine upon us and be gracious to us. May the Lord look upon us with favor and give us peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now I would invite the congregation to be seated and ask if there are any announcements to be raised up for our community at this time. Come, Christmas is right around the corner. You will see at the very top our Christmas Eve Candlelight Communion Worship Service, as always, is on the 24th, and we'll begin at 7 o'clock. It's always a fairly full house, so if you have specific places you want to sit, get here early. But come, we pray a blessing on everyone who comes into this place on that evening. You'll see fairly bold type saying there's some important dates coming up. If you're following some of the movements of leadership and activity within our congregation, you know that we're shifting some of our structure and we have to do it officially. There are mechanisms that are, we talk about constitution and bylaws, but in some respects they are covenants. They are a relationship that we exist in within the sister brotherhood of the ELCIC. And so they are important decisions that we make. They influence us, but there are others that they have an influence on. So we want to talk about it. Please come if you can on these dates, and we'll be giving you more information on what you're actually going to be talking about and voting on, so everyone's in the loop. And then just thanks. This past Friday, we handed out something in the range of 130 Christmas ornaments and letters to households in our neighborhood, just a way of what we hope, giving them a gift, but also saying, we want to be good neighbors to you, we pray a blessing on you, and if you want to partner with us in any way, come and talk to us. It's always a good thing, and we thank those who helped out with that. I think everything else in there, pretty much, you can read through. The lectionary study, those who take part in that on Wednesday afternoons, will take place this coming Wednesday. But thank you to Jeanette Matthew, who will be our host, always so graciously, and we appreciate that, in her home. And then we'll take a little break over the Christmas holidays. So, come out Wednesday at 1:30, and let me tell you, the food is fantastic. So if you haven't come to a lectionary study before, come on down. She'll even give you the address, I suspect. And give thanks to her for hosting us. So let's celebrate. Barb and Dan Jerica. It is your anniversary this coming week, so may the Lord bless you. Oh, surprise. That's what I've been told, so I pray that it's right. But we pray a blessing on you as you celebrate that. And then the birthdays are Zoe Jones and Tali Salzo and Carson Moore. And so let's celebrate together with them. Remember that, grandparents. Let's sing. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Shine, Jesus, shine. go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.